human history is filled with stories of kingdoms and empires, of war and of earthquakes, of floods and drought and disease. This has been since the beginning of time. The Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, tell in each of their chapters the teachings of Jesus about both the tribulation, the precursor of the coming of the end of the world, and also the coming and the return of Christ. You would find those in Matthew chapter 24, and Luke 21, and in Mark 13. Today we'll be listening to it as it comes to us out of Luke's Gospel. Found on page 856, beginning at verse 25. There will be signs in the sun and the moon and the stars and the earth dispersed among the nations, confused by the roaring of the sea and the waves, Jesus says. People will faint from fear and foreboding of what is coming upon the world, for the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now when these things begin to take place, stand up, raise your head, because your redemption is drawing near. Then Jesus told them a parable. Look at the fig tree and all the trees. As soon as they sprout leaves, you can see for yourselves and know that summer is already near. So also when you see these things taking place, you know that the kingdom of God is near. I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, Jesus says, but my words will not pass away. He goes on to say, be on your guard so that your hearts are not weighed down with dissipation and drunkenness in the ways of this life. And that day does not catch you unexpectedly like a trap. For it will come upon all who live on the face of the whole earth. Therefore, be alert at all times, praying that you may have the strength to escape all the things that will take place and to stand before the Son of Man. That is the reading of the Gospel for today. Thanks be to God. Martin Luther was asked some 500 years ago when he was out planting trees on this particular spring day, what he would do if he knew that this was the day that Christ was returning to Christ. And he said rather quickly, I just said, continue to plant my trees until Christ showed up. He didn't say, I'd go running to the church to make confession of my sins to the priest. He didn't say, I would fall on my knees here and pray and ask for God's forgiveness. No, he could say, I will continue to plant these trees until Christ. See, Luther knew deep down inside of himself that he was a forgiven and loved child of God. He knew that and understood that this was what God's will was for him in that day, that he was to be planting trees. It's a good thing to do. And so he was going to continue that work until Christ came. Needless to say, Luther got all of his trees planted, and then some. Even though Luther thought the end of the world would come during his lifetime, because he thought the Antichrist had come, Luther has been dead now for almost 500 years. He also Paul himself thought that he himself would not see death before Christ returned. In fact, there have been many people who predicted the end of the world in my own lifetime. And many of those have died, and yet they're still here. Jesus said, you will not know the day or the hour when I will return. And like a thief breaking into your house in the middle of the night, be prepared, be watchful. In other words, be ready. I think of 22 years ago, there was a book called Heaven's Gate. Do you remember that? Heaven's Gate is open wide, coming from Jesus' life through Heaven's Gate. He thought there was an alien invasion taking place as this comet passed over. And so they went to Walmart and bought some cheap linen clothes, bought some cheap sneakers to put on their feet all the way to the bed to take place. And then they died. Well, that's 22 years ago, and I'm still here. Maybe you remember Y2K, which was really sensitive to do more than that. And many thought that the computers of the world were all going to crash, and that perhaps Christ was coming. Jesus said in chapter 21 of Luke, chapter 24 of Matthew, chapter 13 of Mark, Jesus said, many will come in my name, saying that I am he. But be wary, be watchful of them, because many false messiahs, many false prophets will come in my name. So these things will pass, but remember, they have to come. The point being, not for us to be predicting the Christ's return, but rather that we would be attentive to Jesus' words that said, be watchful, be ready, be prepared. So it really comes down to the question, what does it mean for us to be prepared for Christ's coming? In each of our services this morning, I've been touched by the number of people who have had loved ones in the recent Christian time. We've gathered at Thanksgiving time, we've gathered again at Christmas time, and the pain in your heart. Remember loved ones who have gone before them. And how do we prepare for the coming of Christ is the same as how we prepare for the coming of Christ. Because despite the fact that so many people thought that they would live and Christ would come, that they wouldn't see death, but the reality is that most of us will in fact die, probably, before Christ returns. So in the same way we ready ourselves for death, we ready ourselves for Christ's coming. I'm going to have three brief words. We'll visit them quickly. Then I'm going to go back and touch on each one once again. The first of those is to get your heart in order. Get your heart in order. And how do we get our heart in order? It's fulfilling what Jesus taught, what the Old Testament taught, and that's loving the Lord our God with all of our being, with our whole person. We get our heart in line when we yield ourselves to Christ. We ask Him to fill our life with His presence. The Lord God with all your heart, your strength, your mind, your whole being. And as Jesus went on to say, you cannot love two masters. You can't love God and love God. You must choose who is going to be the Lord of your life. You cannot love success and your job in Christ in the same way. You must choose who is greater. You can't even love your own family in the same way as the author of life. Because as great as our families are, and God calls us to love one another, ultimately it begins in the author of life who gave us our very being. Because not a one of us here is God alone. We are not God. We don't determine the number of days of our lives. But we know that God is the only one who is in charge. And so getting our house in order, getting our hearts in order, is setting our priorities. And secondly, it's doing what God calls us to do. Jesus said, love your neighbor as yourself. Love your neighbor as yourself requires us to love ourselves too, the way it comes ourselves and expects us. And thirdly, to trust the promise that nothing can separate you from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord, for the respect of you. Keeping in mind that nothing separates us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. So let's go back. How do we get our hearts ready for the grave? How do we get our hearts ready for the return of Christ? Because someday Christ will come, the trumpet will sound, and He will return. First of which is getting our hearts in order. So how do we love God with our whole being? It begins by yielding our life and recognizing that as much as we want, we are not in control ultimately of our own life alone. We don't control our own health. We can contribute to our health. We can exercise. We can eat right. We can try to get the right amount of sleep. We can pour buckets of water into our being, try to flush and keep ourselves healthy. But you know what? Sometimes as healthy as we seek to be, life comes through because we don't know the day of the hour. We don't know the number of days in our life. But when we yield our life to the author and give our life to see, we can have peace in the uncertainty. We can have peace not knowing if we will see tomorrow, because we know that in this moment, in this present time, Christ is with us. totally placed into that and said, thank you, God, that you are in control. Now, some of us happen to like to be in control. But we also recognize we cannot control others, can we? The only response or reaction we can control is our own. And so with that in mind, and recognizing that Jesus said, don't worry about tomorrow because today has enough worries of today. We know that as the sun sets tonight, we can't undo what happened today. So we let go and we let God, because only God is in control. Now, if we have offended, if we are living in a broken relationship and we want to make things right, and it's 10 o'clock at night, I'm encouraging us not to touch the phone in the morning, say, please forgive us for what I said today. You know, wait till the sun rises tomorrow, then give them a call, then get together face to face, then work it out. Those are things that we can step into. But ultimately, the only thing that we have control over is how we react and how we live out today. So with that in mind, we get our hearts and heart by yielding our life and the control of our life in that sense. How about doing what God calls you to do today? We don't know the specifics and how God calls us to live out our day today that's going to be unique to each one of us. For some of us, it might mean that we're a nurse and we're heading off to the hospital to work later today. Then we simply do the best that we are able to do with what God called us to do, which is found in our vocation, to be the best nurse caring for the people who are in our care, and letting others to do what they care to do. For the rest of us, it's however our day unfolds. Whether you're going out to cut a tree down and hang some greens up in your house, maybe to rest and enjoy what the day is, maybe enjoying some food together with family or friends as you open up the fridge and enjoy the leftovers that still remain. However that takes shape, it's about loving the neighbor as yourself, but most assuredly loving yourself too. Coming to peace with the God who loves you. Letting go of the worry and the anxiety that's there, the shame and the guilt, and knowing not one of us is perfect, are we? But God still loves us for who we are. So we too must love and come to accept ourselves. Being able to move on in the way that God has given us. Then with the eyes of Christ Jesus, we can see the opportunities that come to allow the light of Christ to shine through us. We see overhead that we have begun the stage as we're getting ready for later Advent and for Christmas as we focus on light, as we begin later this week to hang stars, to get ready for the cantata next Sunday at 7:30 to 9, as we journey deeper into Advent. A time of preparation. A time this year when we're going to celebrate the light has come in Jesus. The light of the world. The light that pushes away the darkness of anxiety and worry. The light that pushes away the fear of life itself. The light that comes to embrace the neighborhood and the community in which we live. Because this is the nature of light. And Christ is the author of light itself. So as we go forth this day, we do what God calls us to do by allowing the light of Christ that fills our life to dispel our own fears, our own worries, to dispel our own discomfort and fill us with the love of Jesus Christ. When we allow that love to shine through us to others with a smile and a kind word, when we greet today with the fullness God gives, we shine the light into our lives today. And may God use us to serve and to show His love, His light to those that we encounter this week in some small way. And may we share the love of Christ, the light of Christ, as we invite others to come and see for themselves that God is still in charge in this crazy world we live in. Point three. And among all the other points, this one hopefully brings it home for us as we prepare our hearts. And that is to trust the promise that nothing can separate you from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord, Romans chapter 8. Nothing not what you do or what you fail to do. It's not what you say or you fail to say. It's not what you think and you fail to think that can separate you from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Claim the promise. Put an end to the voice inside your head that says, I'm not good enough. Because Christ says, I am what you need. Nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. There isn't one of us here. Has that name as a footnote in the Bible that said, God's love is good enough for everybody else except for you. Nothing. Nothing. Except for you. That's what allowed Luther to have such peace when he was planting trees. So I ask you, if Christ were coming later this afternoon, what would you do or not do? Hopefully you'd say, I'm not doing anything I'm too embarrassed about doing. I said, I'm doing what I believe God's calling me to do. And if it's resting on the couch, then rest well. Just open your eyes and be ready to trust me. Because if this should be the last day in which we live, let's make the most of this day that God is giving to us. And if that means resting well, because you're tired, then rest well. It doesn't mean stay up and be more safe. Because you know, if it's the last moments in your life, it really doesn't matter if it continues to grow up the way, does it? Does it really matter if the floor is wet? Does it really matter if our bed is clean? If this is the last moment of our life, may it be that we live it well. Stay with me to say, but do what God calls you to do. And get the most of the joy of today. If this is the day that the Lord is doing, what is the joy to be glad of you? Thanks be to God. I want to conclude today with a scripture that's alluded to in this reading from the Bible. Does he capture fully from the book of Daniel? Something that I quote from their life in Daniel chapter 7, verses 18 and 14. And what it says here, I saw like a human being, that human being in a footnote there says, Son of Man. Do you know who the Son of Man is in scripture? The name of people who are in the church. It's Jesus to us. I saw one like the Son of Man coming with the cloud of heaven. And he came to the Ancient of Days, the Ancient One, and was presented before him. To him was given dominion and glory and kingship, and all the peoples, and all the nations, and all the languages shall serve him when he comes. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that shall not pass away, and his kingship is one that shall never be destroyed. As for all the other kingdoms that have come before, whether it be the Egyptian kingdom, whether it be the Assyrian kingdom, whether it be the Babylonian kingdom, whether it be the kingdom of David, whether it be the kingdom of the Greeks, whether it be the kingdom of the Romans, whether it be all the other kingdoms that have come, including the kingdom that lands in this great nation in which they shall come and go. As for kings and for presidents, for leaders of the house, they come and go, but one kingdom will never end. And its king is the Prince of Peace, the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings, and his name is Jesus. His dominion will never end. This is the one we ultimately serve and follow. Thanks be to God who calls to the Lord this day. Amen. We gather here in the church and we pray.